Good afternoon, everybody. Let me first thank Mr. John St. Joyce, head of the Department of SP College, Economics Department of SP College, Changanashery, for inviting me for this lecture, which is very, 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 very pertinent and very, very timely lecture that maybe students have to know about, you know, what is happening in the country regarding the agriculture sector. And also I thank, like, let me begin with, you know, there are many faculty members I know there in the audience, also my dear students. As Anger already pointed out, you know, this bill has created widespread protest all over the country, which is actually saying that this bill, or this act, not bill right now, act is going to change the entire future of Indian agriculture. Let us see, maybe from my humble knowledge, so let us see that, you know, how it is going to impact in the Indian economy, particularly Indian agriculture sector, and also macroeconomy as a whole. Let me share my screen. Hope my screen is visible to you. Is it visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay. So I titled this lecture as Indian Agriculture and Agriculture Bill 2020. So very straightforward. Like, you know, I'm because, you know, most of you are students, so I just like framed this lecture into a very basic theme. And, you know, first I'm going to discuss something about the status of Indian agriculture. Then I'll come to the agriculture bill and we will discuss about the impacts of agriculture bill, Agricultural Act 2020. Again, I put it agriculture bill here. Yeah. So status, let us see what is Indian agriculture. Everybody talks about Indian agriculture. When we talk about Indian economy, everybody is actually urgency for us to talk about Indian agriculture, its plights, its importance. Why it is so important? Lots and lots of people, more than 50% of the people are depends on this sector. This is one of the vital sectors. 58% of Indian population actually exactly depending for their livelihood in this sector. Gross value added from this sector is about, right now it is calculated about 19.48 lakh crore or 276.37 billion US dollars in the financial year 2020. So the growth in only one sector, that even the first quarter of GDP, that when we calculated, when the government of India declared in 2021, you can see that only one sector that which achieved a little bit positive growth rate is actually agriculture sector. So this is very important sector because of larger sections of the population are depends on this sector for their livelihood. That is why it is very important. But if you look at the contribution to GDP, it is not that big. Less than 14%, 14%. This is also a structural problem that we discuss in the class. Like, you know, our GDP is increasing, our national income is increasing, but at the same time, the dependent population in agriculture is never increasing, never decreasing. Also, the contribution from primary sector is actually coming down to national income. So this we discuss all the time. And we discuss the plight of the farmers. We discuss actually what, since independence till today, we have been discussing about various measures for the farmers, various policies for the farmers. How many of them are actually reaching to those sections of the population? How many of those such policies are giving some kind of smile in the face of poor Indian farmers? So let us see what is happening right now. Look at the irrigated area we have. Just like, you know, even today, I'm talking from 2020 statistics. Just like, you know, 48.8% of the total land area or agricultural land only irrigated. That means the remaining 51.2% still rain fed. So before we discuss about this new act, or before we discuss about how it is going to affect the agriculture sector, we should know, at least, you know, I am reminding you, you know all these things. I'm just reminding you that what is the status of Indian agriculture. Then only you can understand properly about, you know, how this act is going to affect positively as well as negatively for the larger sections of the population. Take it like that, larger sections of the population. I'm not saying it as only agricultural population. I'm saying it as larger section of Indian population. 58% of Indian population, how it is going to affect. Agriculture is a state subject, you know very well. It is not a center subject also. That also we have to be very, very aware about. Then only we can understand what impact this act or this changes which brought in by the government of India to the agriculture sector. So agriculture is completely a state subject. It is not even a concurrent subject. Indian agriculture is largely subsistence agriculture. It is not commercial agriculture. People depending on agricultural sector is for their life sustenance, not for actually what? Surplus making. That is another important factor that we need to keep in mind. Indian food and grocery market is the world's sixth largest, with retail contributing 70% of the sale. This is actually what? This has got lot of connection to agriculture sector. That's why I put this figure. Indian food and grocery market is the world's sixth largest. There are strong agriculture industry linkages in India. So there are strong agriculture industry linkages. So a lot of industries are flourishing in India only because of agriculture as a source of raw materials, not only as a source of raw materials, but also as a source of food. Other sectors, if you want to survive, agriculture sector have to thrive in the economy. Then only we can say that, you know, that sustenance of development or whatever that we call it. The Indian food processing industry accounts for 32% of country's total food market, one of the largest industries in India, and is ranked fifth in terms of production, consumption, export and expected growth. Okay, so that means what? We may be hearing only one side of agriculture, that I said already, like, you know, the sad plight of agriculture. About, I'll tell you about Indian farmers a little later, about, you know, the contribution to GDP, about, you know, the larger depends upon the monsoon, about the lack of productivity, about the duality existing in agriculture, like traditional versus modern agriculture, about, you know, the ruralization of agriculture. So all these things we heard, but at the same time, many agricultural products, we are one of the largest countries of the world. But still, what is happening to agriculture sector? Why this? We all will agree that the plight of farmers, the status of farmers of India actually was very, very, very low. And then they don't have enough at any point of time in their life. That everyone knows that. Why it is so? Why, even though this kind of big sector, which is actually giving very, very, very low to the farmers. Crops, there are three types of crops. This also we need to understand. Like you may be knowing all this. Kharif, Rabi and Zaid crop. There are three period crops are there. Monsoon crop, Kharif, winter crop, Rabi. And then, you know, you can call it a summer crop, Zaid, but at the same time, Zaid crop, you can plant and other periods also. So these are the three crops that we have. Why we have to depend on this? Why we have to classify this entire crop into group of three? Because we are actually, half of the agricultural land is depending on monsoons, rainfall. That's why we have to actually classify this. Otherwise, we don't have to classify this into different groups and all, if enough irrigation facilities are there all over the country. Market size, look at the market size, 2019-20 crop year. Food grain production estimated to reach record 295 million tons. It's a record production, 295.67 million tons. In 2020-21, government of India is targeting food grain production of 298 million tons. Huge production we have. Still we know that a lot of people are dying out of starvation. We have huge production. But at the same time, as we know, we are the second largest populous country in the world. Therefore, we have to feed more mouths inside the country. So therefore, that may not be enough. But actually, this production is enough for the economy. Production of horticulture crops, one of the important items that we have in India, estimated at a record of 320.48 million metric tons in the financial year 20, as per second advanced national income estimates. India has the largest livestock population of around 535 million. which translates to around 31% of the world livestock population. That means 31% of the world's livestock population is in India. This is very, very critical and important as agriculture sector is done. We never actually discuss that area in length and breadth in classes. We maybe tend to discuss only that food grain production or such kind of area only we will be discussing. But this is very important. Why this is very important? Cattle population. This is about 18 to 19% of world's cattle population, which is inside India. We have, as you know, we are the economy with what 18% of world population. But our land area, as India has a land area, is only 2.4% of world's land area. In such situation, if you have this many cattle livestock population also, the density is very high. So you have to find enough fodder and food for livestock population also. And also the space required for livestock is much higher than the space required for human beings. That all these facts we have to take into consideration. But still, we are the largest milk producing country in the world right now, as of today. We produce about 208 million tons of milk. About, we are expecting that financial year 21, so it is about, you know, 195 million tons that we produce right now. We are expecting about 208 million tons. So why I said this? This is also very, very, very important when we talk about, you know, this agriculture lands. Why? Because in India, if you look, it is not like Australia or New Zealand and all. Like, you know, agriculture, if you take, so there they are having a very separate policy for maybe for livestock and maybe for agriculture, in agriculture itself for food grains and other kind of things. In India, it is linked. Livestock development or population or livestock growth is dependent on the agriculture, the land, the, you know, the common agriculture. So that is also kind of, you know, life sustenance for the people, for the rural population of the country. So that is why this area is also, so we as students of economics, we should actually understand from the various dimensions of this problem. Maybe in the media and all, they may be discussing only one particular dimension about the protest and, you know, a lot of things. But the situation is something different, which is very, very intense in the Indian economy. India is among the 15 leading exporters of agricultural products in the world. Maybe this is a shocking figure to you. You may be thinking that we are not exporting at all. We are actually one of the 15 leading exporters. Agricultural exports from India reach, but it is very, very barely minimum, $38.54 billion only. But we are one of the 15 leading. Most of the countries, they won't export actually, because agricultural products, they use it for their own. Largest exporting countries are European countries, China, US, such countries, actually mighty countries, they are exporting in the world. But we do also export. Look at the investments. 90% of agriculture investment in India is happening from private sector. It is not from the government. Government is not investing in agriculture sector. Take the case of industry or MSMEs or other areas and all, government may be investing in a larger scale. But in agriculture, 90% of investment are private sector agriculture or private sector. They are investing in Indian agriculture, not the public investment. According to Direct Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, the Indian food processing industry has cumulatively attracted foreign direct investment equity inflow of about $9.98 billion between April 2000 and March 2020. This is actually not very small. About $10 billion foreign direct investment attracted in food processing industry means that is somehow it is connected to agricultural sector. So that means what? The sector as a whole is benefiting from this foreign direct investment. Okay, so that is also private investment only. So now look at who is Indian farmer. Look at this, 86% of Indian farmers in India are marginal and small farmers. You would have studied this. What is the definition of marginal farmer? A farmer who has a farm up to 1 hectare or 2.5 acres. That is marginal farmer. You can imagine, you can see, maybe most of the farmers in Kerala maybe belong to this farm, this group only. Marginal farmer, like 2.5 acres. It's a huge one. Small farmer means what? From 1 hectare to 2 hectare or up to or from 2.5 acres to 5 acres. That is small farmers. So 86% of total farmers of the country is from these two groups, marginal farmers and small farmers. So this is another important thing. You just keep it in mind while we discuss the act. You need this. So we have to understand what kind of farmer we have. Big farmer is actually what? More than 2 hectares. That is only 14% of total farming, total farmers. 52.5% of all agricultural households were indebted with an average debt of rupees 1,10,000 crore. 10,000 rupees, 1,10,000 rupees according to NABARD. That means what? More than 50% of agricultural households are in debt. In debt. They are in debt. That is why there is a saying, Indian farmers are born in debt, live in debt and die in debt. Indian farmer cannot, we cannot compare Indian farmer with other country farmers. Like, you know, a farmer in US, maybe in WTO agreements and all, they are treating Indian farmer as on par with the farmer from USA. You know very well, a farmer in India is totally, the concept itself is totally different from a farmer that you can see from USA or European or Australia or New Zealand and all. These are major agricultural countries. Okay, so most of the people are in debt. These farmers are in debt. They actually born this world with inherited debt from their parents or from the family, and they'll continue, and every season at every time they may be borrowing this credit from other people or the institutions, and then, you know, they are living in that. Maybe they are getting a small percentage of profit or something, and then they may be dying with that whole lot of debt, and then that is actually inheriting to the future generation. And interestingly, about 35% of agricultural credit requirements are still meeting by middlemen. Even the middlemen is actually, according to law, middlemen is there still even today. As per the statistics, this 35% of agricultural credit requirements are meeting through middlemen. This is also an important thing when we talk about this, the changes in agriculture policy of the country or the new act. Okay, women, look at the women. 33% of cultivators and about 47% of agricultural labor are women. That means what? This is actually, agriculture is actually what is support, a complete support for a family as a whole. That is why you can see that the lot of other dimensions are there, because of lack of time, I am not discussing all those areas. Maybe when questions comes, we will discuss. New Agriculture Act, 2nd June 2020, in the form of ordinances it came, and you know the Rajya Sabha passed, the second, the upper house Rajya Sabha passed this act on 20th September 2020. What is the intention of the government? The government is aiming to double the agricultural income of farmers by 2022. So farmer, you know, government wants to see that agricultural income is increasing double from the present level. From 2020, within 2 years, government wants to see each and every farmer or family household, farming household is getting double income in 2022. And also, it is in line with the India's aspirations to become $5 trillion economy by 2025. That because of COVID-19 and its impacts, we don't know whether we are going to reach that position by 2025 or 2026 or 2027 and all. Because already the economy registered minus 24% GDP in the first quarter of 2021, financial year. So we don't know, but still the aspiration is there. We have right now about 2.85 trillion. That has come down to 2.50 trillion because of COVID. And then we are aiming, we are actually literally trying to double this in 5 years. The GDP also we are trying to double in 5 years by 2025. That means what? When you are actually concentrating only doubling GDP, that may lead to what? Inequality, higher inequality in the country. by understanding that government wants to push or actually push more or give more importance to inclusive growth in the country. That's why the government is trying to push more reforms in agricultural sector. Whether it is really a reform or whether it is really a bad thing for the agriculture sector, we will discuss that. So this is the act that it came in to 20th September 2020. There are three dimensions in this act. There are three dimensions. One is agriculture market, next is contract farming, and third dimension is commodities. These are the three dimensions. For these three dimensions, the government has brought three acts for bringing more changes in agriculture marketing. They have brought the act name Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Act 2020. Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Act 2020. Next dimension is contract farming. Contract farming actually what? Which is actually they are bringing another act, that is actually Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement of Price Assurance and Farm Service Act 2020. That is primarily aiming contract farming or boosting contract farming or reforms in contract farming. Third one is in commodities. Farm Services and Essential Commodities Amendment Act of 2020. This is primarily amending the Essential Commodities Act of 1955, and that actually adding some more dimension to this. See? So as students, you please understand this. I mean, if we actually understand only from the perspective of acts, we may not actually remember this thing. What is for this acts? This act, first act is for agriculture marketing reforms. Second act is only for contract farming, and through that, you know, the government aim is to give more emphasis on contract farming, but supporting some kind of paraphernalia they actually explained in this act. Third one is commodities. Certain commodities they wanted to bring it out from the Essential Commodities Act for to facilitate more flow of commodities in the market. So these are the three dimensions. Why I specifically said that you please remember these three dimensions? Because these three dimensions only actually government is calling as reforms in agricultural sector. But they are not touching anything on this production, productivity and such kind of, you know, or area or those kind of areas. So in the new act is touching only agriculture market, contract farming and commodities. And now coming to agriculture market, that is act, you know, Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Act 2020. I would like to call for a short form, I am calling it as FPTCA. It is not calling by government, I am calling it FPTCA. What is actually the bill says? The Bill on Agriculture Market seeks to allow farmers to sell their produce outside APMC, Agriculture Product Market Committee, APMC mandis, to whoever they want. Now there is a thing, what is APMC? APMC is actually what? APMC is a system brought out in the states, or it is actually established by the state, but in the directions of Government of India to ensure farmers and their safe from safeguarding their exploitation of large retailers, as well as ensuring the farm to retail price spread does not reach excessively higher levels. So what does that mean? That means what? It is kind of a protection for the farmers at the state level with the directions of the central government, and which says that you are having a market at a local level. In that market, you will get a minimum price, even the minimum support prices, procurement prices, such kind of things also started operating through the APMC mandis. It came in 2003. Until 2020, the first sale of agricultural produce could occur only at the market yards or mandis of APMC, that state level, and also states are actually bifurcated to district and local level mandis also there. So the farmers are selling their produce at the local mandis according to the local conditions and local prices and all. So that is one. So the bill is saying that. Now the new act is saying that the farmers can sell the produce outside APMC mandis to whoever they want. They don't have to stick to the state mandis or APMC mandis. They can sell anywhere in the country they want. They can sell their produce. That is what the first agriculture first act says, which is the major reforms brought out by the government of India through this FPTCA act. What are the arguments in favor of that? Freedom to sell their produce anywhere. Anywhere in the country they can produce. Because why this is very, very important? If you look at the production of Indian agriculture, you can see that it is actually geographically isolated. If you look at the rice production or cereals production, you can clearly see that it is starting from inter-Gangetic plain like Punjab, Haryana, and you know, western part of like parts of UP and southern parts of, I mean, northern parts of Madhya Pradesh, and then Haryana, and then coming to Bihar, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, and it is going up to this, that Brahmaputra Valley. So this kind of like, you know, because of this rainfall as well as canal based irrigation, so you can see that these cereals are producing in certain parts of the country. If you go to map, then you can see where is cereals are producing, largely producing the areas that I said. You can clearly demarcate. What is the problem in that? The problem is actually when they produce there or when they harvest there, the harvesting season, the flood of production will be there in that area, and that may lead to decline in prices of their products. So when you force the farmers to sell only in mandis, according to APMC, what will happen? They may get only very less price, or the price is offering through MSP by the government of India. So this is what is happening right now. So now, through the new act, the farmers can sell anywhere in the country. They can take the produce from maybe Punjab and Haryana to Kerala, or like, you know, Karnataka or some other states, so Jammu and Kashmir and all, like, you know, you can divide. You know, these kind of states are not, I'm not saying that not having anything, but largely they are depending upon other states for these kind of products. Next is promote barrier free interstate and intrastate trade for farmers produce. There is no barrier like APMC. Intrastate and intrastate farmers produce, you can actually sell it anywhere, sell it to anybody you want, okay, according to new act. This will actually what? Help the farmers to reduce marketing and transportation costs. Because, you know, maybe according to their profit, according to their situation, they can sell the product anywhere they want. It is not like, you know, a mandi or APMC mandi is earmarking a particular. There are actually what farming societies are there. That farming society is under an APMC mandi, and then that mandi, this farming society has to sell. And then, you know, maybe they don't know whether what is kind of like, you know, price they are going to give. So it was established only for increasing prices. But from 2003 to 20, it's 17 years of existence. You can see that nothing that sort of actually benefiting to the farmers of the country. That is what the argument making by the government. Help farmers to get better price. Now they can sell it to the places where the best price is offering. You would have seen that maybe onion or potato is actually priced less in Gujarat or, you know, like those kind of areas. But, you know, when it comes to the states like Kerala or Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and all, it may be priced very, very, very high, because actually the price is very high, but according to the present system, that higher amount of price is not going into the hands of the farmers. It is going only to the intermediaries. That's what the government says. So the government wants to make sure that the better price is reaching to the farmers. To provide a facilitative framework for electronic trading through ENAM. ENAM already established, that is actually electronic national agriculture market, if to facilitate the national market. Now it is mandi based marketing is going on. Now by using that platform, the farmer can sell anywhere in the country. Now here is assumption is what? Here the assumption is a poor farmer in a local level, he or she should understand all the digital, or she has or he has come some kind of digital knowledge for to operate ENAM facilities. That is what our assumption. But even if it is not there, again, maybe some middleman or somebody will be actually what uprising the situation to farmers, and the farmers are agreeing whatever they are actually entering to the website or online platform and all. But government argument is what this will actually help the farmers to understand the different prices actually existing in the different parts of the country. Therefore, they can sell their produce wherever, whichever the place that, whichever the market they want, by accepting higher price. So that is what the advantage that the government say. And this is actually electronic ENAM, electronic national agriculture marketing. It launched in 2016 April to create a unified national market for agricultural commodities by networking existing APMCs. So it is networking existing APMCs. Anyway, farmer has to sell to APMCs. From APMCs through ENAM, it will go to other parts of the country. It had 16.6 million farmers and 1,31,000 traders registered as on its platform until May 2020. 1,31,000 traders registered. Over 1,000 mandis in India are already linked to ENAM. And 22,000 additional mandis are expected to be linked by 21-22. This is actually ENAM, just for your information. You know, in the newspaper and everywhere, that is discussing about ENAM also. What is ENAM? It is actually electronic national agricultural market. Okay. Yeah. Now, arguments against this act, FPTCA. States will lose the revenue as they won't be able to collect mandi fees. Now, according to the present structure, the mandi fees is there from the mandis. That is a kind of a commission which is going to the state governments, that they will lose as revenue. Now onwards, there is no mandi fees. So that is good for the farmers. But at the same time, the state governments are arguing that that is actually going to collect by the intermediaries or the companies. They may be going to collect for facilitating these facilities. It may eventually end up in MSP-based procurement system. One side, the farmers are worrying about the procurement system itself, that it is going to get abandoned, or the public distribution system itself is going to get abandoned after this act. Maybe after a couple of years of this existence of this act, they are worrying that it may be going to destroy. But as a prerequisite, that because initially this marketing of these products may be based on MSP price. Maybe the newcomers, according to that contract farming, if the new intermediaries, when it comes, they are going to negotiate only on the level of MSP available in the country. That may be another problem that we have to resolve. Electronic trading like ENAM uses physical mandi structure. What will happen to ENAM if mandis are destroyed in the absence of trading? So you don't need mandis right now, and the mandis are going to destroy. Mandis are not needed because you are ENAM. From every village or every farmer's house, you can actually sell the products. Maybe vans, trucks or something is coming and taking it from there. And there, what will happen? And it actually, what physical mandi structure only now existing ENAM is using. But how do you connect this ENAM facility to the local farmers? What kind of actually background they have to get it connected to this? How we can actually get to digitally connected to these areas through ENAM? These are all the questions asking by the farmers. Ultimately, big companies will decide where to sell. Now, if you cannot connect ENAM to different sections of the people or farmers of the country, what will happen? Some company will come and start some kind of facility for online marketing. And then they may be establishing their marketing structure in some place, and the farmers again has to go there and sell their products. Again, a different kind of what mandi system or APMC system will come, but it will be controlling by the private sector. That's what the arguments against this act. Now the second act, contract farming. Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement of Price Assurance and Farm Services Act 2020. I wanted to call it as FAPFA, Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement of Price Assurance and Farm Services Act 2020. What does the act say? The larger goal of the act is to create a new legal framework for contract farming. The Contract Farming Act provides for a national framework on farming agreements. So a national framework is going to come, because now agriculture is a state subject. Different states are actually what they are making. If there is a contract farming facility is there, so different states are having different rules and regulations. This is why against people of this act, which says that it is kind of what centralizing the agriculture activity by the central government, taking the power of state governments to the center. This is another dimension. So Contract Farming Act provides a national framework on farming agreements, a national framework and also a national legal system. Such kind of things are envisaging in this act, Contract Farming Act. Okay, so what are the arguments in favor of FAPFA? The legislation on contract farming will allow farmers to enter into a contract with agri business firms or large retailers on pre-agreed prices of their produce. The farmers are getting the opportunity to enter into business with big companies. This is what the argument in favor of that. In that way, the farmers are expected to get a lot of support for their farming. Not only that, they are also going to get higher prices from this farming business people. Also, they can assure that their products are going to get sold in the market, because a contract is going to sign at a pre-agreed price, even at the time of production. Not after the production, even during the time of sowing itself, they are going to have an agreement with such kind of big companies. This will help them to avoid the fluctuations in production because of the vagaries of nature or other kinds of problems and all. And next one is what? Marginal and small farmers to gain via aggregation and contract. So now 86% of marginal, I told you 86% of farmers are marginal and small farmers. They are getting an opportunity to group together at a local level and can actually what trade with a bigger business firm, agriculture business firm, and in that way their share, profit share, they can enhance. That's what the act says, or that is the aim of the act. To transfer the risk of market unpredictability from farmers to sponsors. Now the unpredictability factor, farmers actually, they are getting an agreement with the agricultural business people even at the time of the sowing season. Therefore, if something happens to that crop, the business people are liable to pay the money to the farmer. So in that way, the unpredictability of the market is actually shifting to sponsors, means these big agriculture business firms than the farmers. Farmers need not actually what suffer from the larger production or the drop in production or whatever. To enable farmers to access modern technology and get better inputs. So when the agriculture business firm will have or is having contact or agreement with the local agriculture people, they may bring the inputs or latest technology, like what high yielding variety seeds or advanced technologies, technologies based on artificial intelligence or data analytics or robotics and such kind of things you can bring in, and that will enhance the productivity of the farm also. That is what another expectation. To reduce cost of marketing and boost farmers' income. Farmers need not worry about the marketing, spending of transportation. So these agriculture business people, they'll be doing entire thing. Okay, farmers can engage in direct marketing by eliminating intermediaries for full price realization. So there may not be any intermediaries, local people are intermediary or the owner of the land may be an intermediary. Such kind of things will not come right now. Now the farmers can sell directly to the agricultural business people. I have a difference of opinion in all this. Let me finish this first. Effective dispute resolution mechanism. Now any dispute comes between contractor or a sponsor and the farmer, or between the group of farmers and all, then there will be a dispute resolution mechanism will be there under this act at a national level. Okay, arguments against. Farmers on contract farming agreement will be weaker players in terms of their ability to negotiate. How do they negotiate? What do they know that, you know, to negotiate with the contract or the big business firm? Big business firms are sending maybe representatives, and the farmers don't know. They are actually, they know only that to get some kind of price, but they don't know better price or good price. So how do they negotiate? So always this from business firm, they will be negotiating for the lower price. Okay, the farmer has to negotiate for the higher price. For that, the farmer has to be informed about the market as a whole, that he have, even after introduction of this act also, the farmer is actually not going to get all information about the whole lot of market of the country. The sponsors may not like to deal with a multitude of small and marginal farmers. They are not going to come and deal with each and every farmers of an area. They may ask the farmers to group together and make a society or a bigger one. In that way, what will happen? They can better manage these local farmers. In that way, the agri-business people can have a control over the entire area. They may be coming and maybe going to control the entire area. That is their worry, the farmers' worry. They have to maybe yield according to the provisions that they are making by these agri-business people. That is their worry. Being big private companies, exporters, wholesale and processors, the sponsors will have an edge in disputes. Even the dispute settlement area also, because of these companies, maybe big companies, they are coming and doing agriculture business, and then, you know, they may be having upper hand in negotiations or disputes if it is arising. So that is actually another worry of the farmers. It may go from the right of deciding the price of farm or output may go from their hand to the agri-business people. That's what another worry they have. Next is actually what? Third one is commodities. Farm as Services and Essential Commodities Amendment Act 2020. I wanted to call it as FSCCA. The essential, I put it two times, forgive me. The Essential Commodities Amendment Act 2020 allows the central government to regulate the supply of certain food items only under extraordinary situations. Now, according to the present Essential Commodities Act of 1955, if some issues comes, you can actually what? Restrict the supply of products by using the act. Because sometimes if famine or like an extraordinary price rise or natural calamity or something comes, right now any products the government can declare as what? The state governments can declare as it is actually what? Essential commodity. In on that basis, or the central government will declare and the state government will follow. On that basis, the people who produce that cannot hold that products. And now what is happening is, there is a shift is happening in this act, which says that unless and otherwise there is a situation like war or famine or extraordinary price rise or natural calamity, such kind of situation only the government can enter and can have a what regulation over the supply of food products. Otherwise, you cannot actually control this food product supply, and certain products completely it is gone out from this list. So stock limits may be imposed on agricultural produce only if there is a steep price rise because of war or famine or natural calamity and all. Such, who will decide that? What is the steep price? So that actually it is in the act, it says that the act will enforce only when there is 100% increase in retail price of horticulture product. It has to be 100% increase in product, horticulture product, or 50% increase in retail price of non-perishable agricultural foodstuff over the price prevailing immediately preceding 12 months, or average retail price of last 5 years, whichever is lower. You can see that for the, you take the last maybe 3 decades of Indian economy or Indian agriculture, you never experience such a situation of like 100% increase in retail price of horticulture produce or something when compared to previous year. Okay, there may be some situations, but it won't stay long. But it is actually for to get qualify a product to get into the Essential Commodities Act, you need this kind of conditions. Then only government can declare. Otherwise, the business people are free to hold those products. So as long as they can hoard products, it is not like hoarding the products presently by the farmers, because presently by the farmers, they cannot hoard for more time because it may be perishable. But for the agri-business people who are coming into contact or contract with these poor farmers, they are having better infrastructure to keep this foodstuff for longer time period. In that way, they can enjoy more higher prices in future. This is what going to happen. Nothing contained in this subdivision shall apply to any order relating to public distribution system or the TPDS made by government under this act or under any other law for the time being in force. They are actually cautioning. It is actually, if state government is having some kind of law related to PDS or TPDS and all, it may not have any kind of implications in this, they are saying. But still, farmers are worrying. This is not only a farmer worry. This is a worry of the country also. It may actually, the farming agri-business people may decide that which products that we have to release right now or not. Seeks to remove commodities like cereals, pulses, oil seeds, edible oils, onion and potatoes from the list of essential commodities acts. All kinds of cereals, pulses. Raising the standard of living of the farmers, getting the majority population out of sufferings, professionalization of agriculture, introduction of separate policies by states, and the question of federal structure of the government, because the central government is forcing the state government to follow this. And you have already seen that states like Punjab and all, already they actually introduced the counter policies against this. This is actually happening right now. So we can discuss if time permits later on. So if agriculture fails, everything else will fail. You cannot leave agriculture like that to every like that to the market. If agriculture fails, everything else will fail. If you ate today, thank a farmer. If you ate today, thank a farmer. We are all living because of the farmer. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable words. Now we have an open forum session. Participants can ask their doubts or queries regarding this topic to our resource person who will be answering them. Also, we have been receiving certain questions via our chat box. So, sir, if you could please answer them. Also, to our viewers joining via YouTube, you can also send in your questions via the YouTube live chat box and we will be redirecting it to sir.
So I can see that lots and lots of questions, big questions are there. I don't know whether I can finish reading and answering. So one question from Milan. Since the big farms don't like to do business with small farmers, don't you think that there might be someone to be an intermediary, as the majority of farmers in India are illiterate and not having proper education to negotiate with the farms, leaving the same situation in future? Don't you think so? Very interesting observation. I can tell you one example. What is happening with the Jan Dhan Yojana? Just see that. You have reports available. You know what is happening right now? Jan Dhan Yojana, it's a very good program for the poor people, for the local people of the country. And then, you know, if you can have a bank account, they can actually what? They can think about the surplus. And we know that we study in economics that, you know, macroeconomics, marginal propensity to save, which is very, very poor in the among the rural poor people. So to enhance that, to create some kind of surplus, if they can create, what will happen? They'll think about the future. That's the idea of Jan Dhan Yojana. But what happened that Jan Dhan Yojana, you have chartered a lot of accounts, but what is happening, as you rightly said, now the accounts are actually operating by the middlemen. Government report says, government also said that, but it is not the problem of the policy. It is actually we call it just like, you know, we call it as behavioral changes of the people, behavioral attitude. The last economic survey, if you read, you can see that whole lot of discussion they are talking about this behavioral edge, you know, like, you know, that kind of discussions are happening here also. I would say the government aim is actually what that Taylor's theory, that actually which is trying to incorporate into agricultural situation right now. So it can happen because the farmers are not, I told you about ENAM, they are not actually equipped with the skill of operating ENAM market. Now the mandis are disappearing. What will happen? The farmers are forced to group into farming groups, and then they have to sell these business people, and business people may actually, what their representative may come and it can happen, middlemen. No wonder that it can happen. I agree with you. If today, if it is agreed to pay ₹20 for a crop, but in future if the price increases to 60 to 70 rupees for the same, then do you still think our farmers will get the increased amount? Yeah, that actually it's a contract loss. That point is not that valid. That point you can incorporate always by using the government agencies, because government now saying that local bodies and state governments can have a power to control that, because you know they can have a contract for one season or three seasons or five seasons or something like that. That is dependent. So maybe after two seasons or three seasons, if price increases, they can have a better contracting, and different kinds of contracting are there. So this problem you can actually eradicate through such kind of contracting. Next question from Anne Jacob. Recently a news came out regarding the underperformance of India in global hunger index, even below the ranks of neighborhood states, which is a serious threat to our food security. Also million tons of produce is getting wasted in between. India's problem is not regarding the production but of distribution. Keeping in mind all the demerits of Agriculture Act, do you think that this act can improve the distribution of gains in a country? This is another very good question and observation. So we are actually kind of 94th rank in the global hunger index, and then you know she is worrying about that distribution. This is what the government says, that distribution can get improved with the employment very structured big companies. They will use all mechanism to get distributed because they are looking for profit. So they will distribute to different parts of the country by using that mechanism. But we don't know if it is going to benefit your people, all sections of the population or not. That's what I said. It is a $1 million question. We don't know what. Let us see. But I believe that this may be going to be a confusion. Instead of introducing all these three acts together, the government would have, in my opinion, the government could have go for step by step, one by one. Because, you know, now the government position, government explained in the parliament is what? Because most of the people actually back out, but still some explanation came from the agriculture minister. He was saying that, you know, this is actually, if three these acts together, it is not coming. You know, the complete aim of the fruitfulness of the changes in agricultural policy of the country will not get effectively in the economy. That's what he said. So maybe because, you know, all these three acts are completely interdependent, that may be the reason why they introduced. But from the farmer side, this three together is going to be a big bang for them. It is kind of a big shock for them. They wanted to change the entire system immediately. So that will create a lot of confusion, a lot of problems. And we can hopefully, because, you know, on the one side, even though I am saying, on the other side, I wanted to see the agricultural sector of the country is improving and the farmer is coming out and getting enough. Look at Kerala also. Farmers, the major problem of agriculture is farmers are not getting income that is required. Or like remunerative income, that we call it as remunerative income. They are getting income, but remunerative income they are not getting. If remunerative income, if they are not getting, they won't invest. The agriculture will not flourish. So we are all aiming to this big country, or you know, like $5 trillion country and all. But if your food sector fails, that is the government worry. Maybe the government actually trying to push more of like, you know, infrastructure and the productivity improvement in agriculture sector. So again, Milan, another question asked, so don't you think there is a structural gap in this implemented as at present, the farmers are not having enough knowledge. I already said this. But that doesn't mean that we should not initiate, you know, this kind of reform. We have to start initiate reforms. If the proper marketing is not done, or if the proper prices are not getting by the farmers, then the problem is actually what? Still, you know, if we are just talking about the improvement in agriculture even now, but improvement is not happening. So some kind of initiation has to happen. But that doesn't mean that completely destroy the extension sector. That's what I use the term, agriculture is a culture in India. So you cannot destroy that entire existing culture and bring back. But for an industry, it is totally different. It is kind of what? It is kind of, you know, agglomeration. Like, you know, one area, maybe one kind of industry, you need to destroy only that. But that may not affect the economy as a whole. But agriculture is not like that. Almost all part of the country, it is kind of a culture and it is kind of a livelihood of the people, sustenance of the people. Or if something in that structure happens, then that may be a problem for the whole economy. That's what I think. Okay? Yeah.
Sir, hello?
Yeah, please.
Pijetov sir has one question, I think. So.
Yeah, I can make a comment. Shaiju sir, thank you. I'm Thomas PJ from HP College.
Oh, thank you, sir. Yeah, please go and ask questions, sir. You can make the comment.
Well, thank you for the wonderful talk. It's very expository in nature. You are trying to kind of expose. But I have a comment to make. That is, I don't know who said politics is the mother of economics. So, can you hear me?
Yes, I am hearing.
Now, in all these acts, whether it is the Citizens Act or it is the devaluation of money or all the, or is GST, all the reforms that this government is, or the government has made, we can say that it failed on the ground. And I think the same would be the fate of this act also. In other words, what I'm trying to say is that we should not fail to see the politics behind such acts, because one point I want to say make is about the federal structure of the country. So now there is an increased tendency to rule India from Delhi. Now it is more of a Delhiization, Delhi-centric rule. So in other words, what I'm saying is like agriculture, if you centralize and if you hastily make these reforms, I feel that it's neither good for the farmers, nor for the people, or not for the country. So, for example, the question you said, Indian farmer lives and dies in debt. This doesn't say anything about that aspect of capital required for agriculture for the farmers. Now, you could have done a lot of useful reforms, but all these reforms are, I must say, with a special politics in mind, and that is to centralize power in and around India. And I just like to hear more from you on such tendencies that the present government is making.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I absolutely agree in the last part that you said about what centralization of agriculture that maybe the government is trying to do. But in my opinion, that's what my opinion I wanted to say, because I don't want to be partisan with any politics or anything that the government or any party that they are doing. But I wanted to say one thing that, like, you know, central level, some kind of directions has to be there for the prosperity of agriculture. But that doesn't mean that completely controlled by using some acts. But in this acts, the government is not trying to take entire decisions on the center, but the government is actually giving directions. That's why the other states, actually, they are coming with you know, various other policies that is there. But one important problem is actually, maybe politics is there. That's for sure. Politics is there. Politics in the sense that, you know, like, you know, but what kind of politics is this? I just wanted to know that what kind of politics, if major people are not, you know, satisfied, then, you know, why they wanted to introduce such a policy? You mentioned about demonetization. So we economic students, we say that actually if the government is actually what government is thinking that if a policy is going to backlash the entire prosperity or entire prospects of politics, entire prospects in politics of a government, why do they introduce that? That means what? Maybe they are looking for like some kind of changes which they wanted to bring into the economy. But at the same time, you know, the hasty introduction of such policies can harm the entire structure of. So that is what I'm not saying, that I'm not completely agreeing what the government introduced through these acts. But at the same time, certain areas, because, you know, if the government cannot do investment in agriculture sector, someone has to, we have to promote someone to do investment in agriculture. But at the same time, that is not at the cost of the prosperity of the farmers also. That area, we have to be very, very vigilant, and we have to control that. That is the only thing I wanted to answer. And other things, I agree that what sir said, like, you know, it is a very good observation. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.